Hello, my name is Bart Volbra. I'm going to tell you something about what I'm doing right now, what kind of business I have, and how I've got to where we stand now with our business. So I just started the business like you guys, studying communications, but not in Groningen. I've studied in Leeuwarden, and it was about, I think almost 20 years ago, so it's a long time ago. I did not finish in 4 years, but I tried, but I lived in Leeuwarden and I was studying and I was a student, so there were lots of parties and distractions, but all in the end I finished and I got my diploma, so all is good. When I was studying communication, I chose the minor of graphic design, so that's my base. In the last year of my study, I did an internship on an events bureau. They sold theater shows to theaters and artists to events. So my job there was to monitor the ticket sales. So that was kind of the boring part because it's a lot of administrative work. But I also could design the posters they would hang all around the cities to let people know that the theater show is coming to their town and they can buy tickets. So there was a lot of communication between me and the different theaters all across the country to index how many tickets there were sold. And if the need was there to give it a bit of more attention, to put a little bit of more of marketing in it. So it were the early days of social media, so we did not do a lot on Facebook because Facebook was practically non-existent in Holland at that time. We had Hives though, so that was good. Hives is some kind of Facebook Lite, I guess. When I was doing my internship there, it went very well. They were very happy. So after my study, I was working. I could work there. They asked me if I would work there full time. I did do that at first. I also had that was the early days of me in the search of being an entrepreneur. So with a friend of mine, I had a company in designs for t-shirts, not t-shirts SO, because we did not have stock. But we designed prints for t-shirts and prints for other kinds of clothes, like sweaters or sometimes even panties. It was really funny because we did some really funny designs on them. It was just a small business, so not much about it, but one time we had a little success. There was a commercial in Holland from a big telecom provider, KPN. KPN had a commercial, and in that commercial there was a company, and they made a whole lot of spelling mistakes in their texts. So everybody was coming there, and they said "Goeie mochel."
Goeie
mochel. And goeie mochel. It sounds really weird in for you, I think. But it's like a good day, but then with a lot of spellings mistakes in it. So it became kind of a cult thing in Holland. And everybody was saying goeie mochel,
goeie mochel
to each other. So it was very much a hype. And we printed this text, goeie mochel, on t-shirts, and we sold them in our own shop. And when people ordered them, the order went to Germany, and in Germany the t-shirts got printed, and they handled the payment, and they handled the shipping and everything. The only thing we got was a kind of a commission on every sold piece of clothing. So one day I was working on our like little t-shirt company together with my friend Eric and Eric, and I was sitting there and we got a mail, and the mail was from KPN. So we were we were kind of scared because we did not checked in on the how do you call it, on the rights of this of this text, so we were like, oh, they want us to take everything offline because we are misusing their brand. But that was not the case. So we opened the mail, and they said, yeah, we really like what you're doing, and maybe we can work together on something. So we were hyped, of course, and we called with the KPN, and they said, yeah, we would like you to make another shop, but only put stuff in it from this commercial. It's only text from this commercial, texts with spelling mistakes. So we made a shop for them, made some designs for t-shirt prints with the spelling mistakes in it, and it was a success. So people would just buy it, and we get the commission, and we were happy, the people were happy, KPN were happy. So that was kind of like a fun little success, which made me realize, you can start a little company with not so much. Now, we didn't earn that much money on it. I think we could go one time on a skiing trip of it, but it was just nice working together and seeing people buying these designs we made. But it was a lot of effort for not so much commission, so we didn't continue this company after. I was still working at this event bureau, but now for 4 days a week. And one day a week, I was busy with my own company. My own company is called VLBD. And this VLBD company, I went into the graphic design. So I was creating my own network with my own customers, making designs, making logos, making visit cards, like little company cards, websites also. I started making websites then in WordPress. I still do that, by the way, but I'll come back to it later. So that was the early days of me looking for a way to make money on my own. But I was working 4 days a week with this event bureau. So I made some money there, and my motivation was not so high to fill that other day with my own stuff, because I was making enough money to get around. Then later on, the Dutch government changed some things in the tax for the cultural sector. And that means that everything from theater shows to theater tickets to fees for the artists, everything went up, because they taxed it to 21% instead of 9% what it was at first. So you already know, of course, when things get more expensive, there's a dip in how much is getting sold. So the sector is getting some hard punches, And also this event bureau is getting some hard punches. And we were like, okay, we have to downsize. They were already not a big company, but they had to downsize to stay alive. And I was going to do some freelance work for them. And yeah, just so work for them when needed and focus totally on my own company. So that was kind of a motivation to get it right, because yeah, I had to. So I worked a little for them. I worked a little for my own company, but it was not much. So when you're starting, it's difficult to get new clients, because you don't know that much people. But more important, not much people know you. So when people don't know you, or do know you and don't know what you do, they are not going to ask you if they need a design or a website or whatever, videos. So that's my first tip. Put energy in creating a network. And by creating a network, it's not about going to specific network meetings. That's not the most important thing. The most important thing is that you know what you do and tell it to people. And it doesn't even matter that much if those people are becoming clients of you. It's just getting that everybody gets to know who you are and what you're doing. So that's creating a network. So I was just struggling a little bit to get around, but then I saw an opportunity to do freelance work at an advertising agency, and it's a big advertising agency in Friesland, and it's called Akkengaar Communicatie, by the way. I don't know if you know it. It doesn't matter that much, but I could do some freelance work for them. And the freelance work was consisted of doing some desktop publishing work. So not really what I wanted to do, but it was an opportunity to get into it, to get into the advertising agency and see how they work and maybe get a bigger network. So I went there, met some other freelancers also, because we were hired on a bigger project, and the project was creating these booklets for different studies of one of the schools here in Leeuwarden. It was a bigger project, so it took a couple of months. So it was a real steady income, and it was nice. After this was finished, this project there, I got to know people there, of course, because I was there every day. And they asked, are you willing to do some more freelance work, but on a little bit of more of a ad hoc base, like we call, and then you can go freelance at the studio. So yeah, of course, that's nice. So then I got the opportunity to work in a studio environment. And the studio environment is about design and desktop publishing, because the advertising agencies are mostly consist of four different departments. It's like account managers, project managers, the creative direction, and the studio. So the bigger accounts are everything is getting designed by the creative direction, but they also have smaller accounts, and the smaller accounts don't have this big budgets like the bigger accounts do. So most of the times these smaller accounts are getting picked up by the studio for the design. So not only for the desktop publishing, but also for the design. And that's where I got more experience with designing for other other companies. So yeah, that was good. I also learned a lot about the different programs, even more than I did at the study, because you are working the whole day with just Illustrator or InDesign or Photoshop or whatever. Yeah, because you have to. So that was really good. But then a lot of my income came from this company. And that's not really healthy, because if they quit or they don't have enough work for you, then most of your income is going away because you're a freelancer. So I was looking for another ways to make my income more healthy. So I looked into other advertising agencies that hire freelancers. And because I had a lot of experience then with advertising agencies, I could easily transit to another one, because you can just say, yeah, I've got some studio experience like there and there. And they were like, okay, you can freelance here also. So then I got to work at Junction, and Junction is a big company in Leeuwarden. They're bigger even than that other one. And there I could do things for Heineken, Coca-Cola, Albert Heijn. Yeah, like because they're more national / international based. But then, yeah, that was all fun, and it brought me some new experience, a new network, of course, and some kind of steady income. But yeah, when you're the only thing with freelance is it gets you income, but you're just giving a lot of time to other companies. And that's time you don't put in your own brand, in your own company. I was looking to get more projects of my own, you know. Around that time, I came across Eduard, and I know Eduard from a long time ago. Eduard was a classmate of mine on the middle school, and we get in touch again. And Eduard is like a journalist, still a journalist, I think, and also very strong in video. So he's a journalist, strong in video. I'm strong in communication and design. So we thought, yeah, that could be a nice
combination.
Nice combination. So we decided to work more together, and it went well, and we could work together, and we could help each other out in some projects. So on a certain moment, we were like, yeah, maybe we have to start this business together. So we created a business together, and we called it Hatoch Kruller. It was a Hatoch Kruller, and it's a Danish name, and it means hat, because Eduard's wearing a hat sometimes, and I've got curls, so it means hat and curls in Danish. It's a funny name, it's a funny story, and people always ask, what does it mean? So we can always tell a story about what does it mean. And you can say, yeah, it's a difficult name, but because people always ask what it means, you can always tell something about it, and people, maybe they don't remember the name, but that's not the most important, because people remember us. And so they know who to call and what to do. So we created this company, strong in video, strong in design. We got a slogan. The slogan we have is fantastic marketing, so tactical marketing, and we create fans, so we don't create customers, but we try to make their brands like popular with their customers so they become fans. And you can rather have fans than customers, because fans will tell about your company and create more customers. That's the whole thing. So we believe in that. So we started this, and we create videos, animations. I still created the websites and design. Whenever a customer comes with us, that was also a part of our company philosophy, is that we don't immediately take on the project. A lot of times people come with us with a question, I want a video. And then we think, okay, you want a video, we can do that, but what do you want to do with the video? Well, we want to, sell a product, for example. So then we go talk to these companies and take a little step back, because people always think in means of communication. So in a video, or a poster, or a brochure, or anything. But sometimes that mean of communication is not the best for telling the story they want to tell. And so we take it a step back, and we are going first in a concept phase. And in this concept phase, we look into what their company is about, what their company values are about, and what they want to sell, or who they want to reach. And with these values, and with all variables we are taking out of it, we can make a better product for them that tells the story they want to tell. And sometimes that means that if they come with us with a question, we want a website, then we say, yeah, that's nice, but your story is better in an animation on a website, or a video, or sometimes even working together with some blogs or something, like, you know, to reach the target group they want to reach. So that's one of the important things. Take a step back and look into what you want to achieve. Not just make a video, not just make a website, not just make a post, but what do you want to achieve with that mean of communication? So that's why the concepting phase is so important to make the best mean of communication, to give the company, the client, the best thing they need. So yeah, Eduard and I are doing that most of the times. But sometimes, because of now the Corona crisis, sometimes things go different than you, than you have foreseen. So in the beginning of this crisis, we had a customer here in Leeuwarden, and they organized big events like Caravana. It's like an
camping event.
It's an event, and you can look into new campers. You can look into new tents. It's really big. It's in a big halls, and there are a lot of camps, a lot of tents, and activities. So a lot of people come there. But of course, because of Corona, that is not possible anymore. We created content for them, like photos or videos for social media. They cannot organize these events on this time, so everything we had planned for them just fell away in like a day. So that was a bit of a bummer. But on the other hand, we got some opportunities. And these opportunities consist of streaming. So streaming was is now, of course, really hot on the internet. A lot of people doing it. And we started to do some small-scale streaming in 2017, 2018 for the University of Groningen here in Leeuwarden for some events like the opening of the academic year and some lectures in the pub. So we got all this equipment already and we got some experience already. And when the crisis in 2020 hit us, one of our employers asked, yeah, we want to do a lot of streaming because they're a culture company. They had some budgets, but they couldn't do events anymore. So they asked if we could help them out. And yeah, of course we could. We had experience. We had the equipment. So we had to do some adjustments because everything was on locations and some things were even not on a steady location, but like walking. So we had to make some technical adjustments, but yeah, at one time we did like 10 streams for them a week. So every Sunday we did classical music from a unique location in Friesland. Every Monday we stood on the roof of a pop podium in Leeuwarden in Neushoorn, and that was about rap and hip-hop. Every Tuesday we went to another town, Drachten, where Maurice lives. there's a cafe and we did Friesian music there. And every Wednesday we did a tour in a museum. So we went with the museum director or the exposition leader and walked around the museum, and they told us what we saw there. And so we streamed it and people at home could visit the museum through our streams. Every Thursday we had a singer-songwriter thing in a cafe in Leeuwarden. And Fridays, we had like a Friday afternoon drink with a local hero in Leeuwarden. He's called Danny Panadero, look him up. He's a really funny guy. He did a 1 hour show every Friday. And every Friday night we had a rock music where Maurice helped us out a lot. So that's, thank you Maurice. Because Eduard and I were Fridays with our own streaming for our own platform, the Friesian Vlogger. I'll tell you later about this. Every Saturday we did a little walk through different cities, city tours. So there was a guide and he was, we were just walking with him through a city for like an hour and a half, and he was telling us about the buildings, our gravity, our little alleys in the cities. It was really fun. It was really, really popular. People were really enthusiastic about seeing these different cities and just getting to know some cultural aspects. That was fun. And every Saturday night we did DJs live streaming, also from the pop podium Neushoorn. So that was really fun to do. And then Sunday the whole process started over again. So we had a really busy year eventually in 2020, which we were not expecting at all, because at first a lot of projects were just going down the drain. It was a really special year for us. We're now at this moment busy with our own company still, of course. The streaming has got a little bit less, but we're now more into the webinars. So we created our own platform called StreamPool. In StreamPool we do some webinars for big government things like Provincie Drenthe, Wetterskip, it's also some government thing in Friesland, tourist bureaus, and what we do for them is we create like this little kind of TV formats for an hour or so, and we send it via our own webinar platform so people can watch it, people can ask questions and chat with each other. The questions are getting answered in this webinar, in this kind of TV show. We design things for these TV shows because every TV show is unique, of course, so we make some titles in After Effects, some transitions, intros, outros, yeah, everything. So it's really custom. And everything is on location. There's a lot of companies that now have their own little studios from which you can stream. But I think our unique thing is that we can stream from practically every location you can imagine. And that's because the experience we now have, because of the year 2020, where we did, I think around 200 streams on, very, very random locations, from rooftops to harbors to an old abandoned church, for example. So that's our new opening. We've got the webinars. That's the new possibility we discovered. That is even possible. Because of this crisis we are now in. So seeing possibilities is a big thing. I think you need to have if you wanting to become an entrepreneur. I should tell you something about the streaming Edward and I did on the Friday nights, because we have this channel on YouTube called the Friese Vlogger. It's a vlog in Frisian. Edward is also already vlogging from the early days of our company. He was also already vlogging for himself, and then we rebranded this his vlog to the Friese Vlogger. We're now currently at 9,000 subscribers, I think. And that's just a great outlet for us to show what we're capable of, but also to build on our own audience. So it's not about advertising our company. We sometimes, of course, the vlog is here in the office, so they see the office, and sometimes Hartgekrul, a name is dropped, but it's never about it. It's more about people and people Edward meets on the street. It's a great way to get people to know what you do and who you are, and see that you can make a nice video that people are willing to watch, because there are 9,000 subscribers, of course. So when the crisis started, we streamed also for ourselves. That was also a way to interact more with the followers, but also to experiment a little bit with new technologies that we needed, of course, for the rest of the streams we were going to do, because it was like 10 streams in all different locations, and we had some new equipment and we have to test it out. So that was a great way to try and test it. Does it work? Does it work what we want to do? So that was a nice story about Edward's vlog. So what I want to emphasize is, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you have to build your network. So let people know who you are and what you do. And that's a big thing. Just if you were in a pub, whenever it's possible again, or just with your family, when you're dining with some family members or something, just let everybody know what you do, because if people don't know what you do, then they never are going to call you if they need something. Next thing, what's very important is, of course, seeing all different possibilities, but not seeing them, but also trying them. We've tried a lot of things, and obviously not everything was a success, but I only tell you about our successes. If you want to know our fails, I can tell it another time, because we need a little bit longer then. So seeing possibilities and just trying, going for them, that's a great deal. And also, and maybe I didn't tell enough about it now, but trying to get the values and the variables you need to make the means of communication is very important. So make sure you have a good concept, so you know what you're going to do, but also the client knows what you're going to do, is very important. Because people come to you, say, yeah, we need a video, and then you're just rolling and just doing something. Yeah, it's most of the time it's not going to work. So make a good concept, make a strong concept, and then you get a strong end product.